This is Dan Schneider on this Dan Schneider video interview. It is another of my Actors on Acting series. Melanie Chartoff is the woman before you. I'll be talking about her life, her career, and the art of acting. The conversation will begin when we return. American actress Melanie Chartoff is my guest. She has a career that goes back to the 1970s, in fact, and she has been on major network television. She's done voice acting, she's done theater, she's done all sorts of things, comedy and drama. And I just want to welcome her and ask her if she could give a little bit of background about where she came from, her growing up, family, and that sort of thing. So welcome, Melanie.
Thank you very much. I'm from New Haven, Connecticut, a big theater town. We had the Schubert Theater where they tried out lots of pre-Broadway shows. We had the Long Wharf Theater, which is an excellent repertory company. And, of course, we had Yale University where I got started on the stage with other actors rather than in my imagination as a sort of disassociative process to escape my unhappy family.
Well, let's talk about the unhappy family for a moment then. Were you an unhappy artistic family like a Eugene O'Neill's family?
Oh, nothing quite so theatrical as that. No, let's see. My dad was an entrepreneur salesman. My mom was just a mom for the first 10 or 12 years of my life until my dad got ill and then my mom had to go to work. My mom had a beautiful singing voice. She'd been a small town opera singer. She had a gorgeous soprano. My dad was a frustrated writer. Neither of them ever made a living at what their dream was, so I think that there was a lot of investment in my talents, which began to emerge at a pretty early age. I was desperate for attention as soon as my little sister was born. I think this is pretty common. She sort of got the room away from me, and then I had to do all kinds of tricks to kind of get the room back. I was the first baby born to a family of four grandparents and a bunch of siblings. And then, of course, once they all started having their own children and my sister was born, the crowd left my room. So I started performing very early. Being funny was like a defense mechanism. And I would trip out in my imagination a great deal, had a very rich fantasy life. Rather than serving tea to my dolls, I would tie them up and then rescue them, pretending that I was an Indian. I had all these elaborate kind of sadistic fantasies with my dolls. So I had a very rich imagination at a very young age. I think I integrated a lot of Soupy Sales. It was one of my father's favorite shows, and Steve Allen, which was the only show I was allowed to stay up and watch my father. And the Cowboy shows that my father loved so much. And they all became these elaborate rituals that I staged in my room.
I know when I was a child, I used to have my stuffed animals, and I used to tape up a Maxwell coffee house or coffee can, and I'd have a little Nerf ball and have my animals play basketball games against one another. So were you more into your own world than, say, watching television or watching the movie star magazines of the day?
I wasn't aware of who the movie stars were, but I know that once in a while, Mom and I would cuddle in her bed and watch some of those late afternoon films, the older films that were on. And I loved Carol Lombard. She was a great idol of mine. She was so natural and real and so accidentally sexy and funny without ever pushing. So I certainly aspired to be like her. But I didn't really know I wanted to be an actress. I was more of a writer as a child. I had poetry published in local papers in the New Haven Register. And I seemed to be attracted to the arts, and I sang, but I didn't have a concept of having a career until I was about 13, and I went to Long Wharf Theater, and they were doing a production of Volpone. And one of the actors was playing the role of Mosca. He walked through the audience as the narrator, and at one point he touched me on the cheek and spoke part of his monologue to me, and that was the day I decided I want to do that too. I want to be on the stage and invite other people into an imaginary world. I don't just have to do it in my bedroom. I can actually do it on a stage or maybe on the television.
Since you would have grown up in the 50s, did you get to watch things like Mary Martin doing Peter Pan back then?
And I did see that, yes, I did. But I didn't have a concept of what a career even was. I was attracted to performing. I remember in junior high, I played the lead in a couple of plays. And then in high school, I did a couple of plays of some Ibsen, some Noel Coward, and then I started auditioning at Yale University they didn't have women enrolled at Yale University in those days, and whenever they needed a girl, I got to audition and be in some of the plays like Three Penny Opera, The Rhinoceros. So they had a great deal of money at Yale, and I got spoiled as to what theater would be like.
Yeah.
Very elegantly, expensively done.
Well, I do want to get and talk about theater because I've got a sort of bias. I think that it's probably the most pure form of acting because you're actually gauging the audience interest sometimes there. But before I do, I'm looking on your own website, MelanieChardoff.com, and I'll link to it below this video. And it says that you mentioned the Three Penny Opera. Did you actually first want to be a singer? You said your mother had a good voice, I believe. Did you actually want to be a singer-performer rather than an actress first?
No, I didn't think of it that way. I would harmonize with my mother in order to get the dishes done. That was her enticement to get me to try the dishes. But no, I liked acting and pretending more than I liked singing. I didn't think my mother was a good actress, singer, although she was a lovely singer. Her heart wasn't really always in it. And then when she liked to listen to operas, I found them very distasteful because I found the behavior so over the top or melodramatic that it didn't really appeal to me. However, when my mother went to musical comedies out of the library, like Fiorello or South Pacific, then I started to hear real feelings in the voices, and that's when it became more appealing to me. And since I had a natural flair for singing anyway, those were the first sorts of jobs I got in musical theater.
Yeah, it's interesting you mention that because you're one of the few actors that's ever talked about opera or even musicals in the sense that I know when I was a kid, I never could get into musicals. My first film I recall seeing was Julie Andrews, 40 Feet High at New York City, Radio City Music Hall, you know, doing The Sound of Music. But other than that, it being how, wow, she's so pretty and so big. I do remember not particularly liking musicals because it always seemed, okay, here you have the Sharks and the Jets. They're supposed to be, you know, these tough guys. And then all of a sudden they're singing and doing these balletic moves. And it just seemed so dissonant. So you yourself noticed that too, that there was a sort of dissonant that turned you off to opera at least?
To opera, and except for Porgy and Bess, which I found the performance that I saw in New Haven, where I found the performances so much more full of passion and organic feeling than I had the operas, which seem to require a false stance and such an effortful way of technically singing that it was very hard for me to feel anything from them, except the effort. Of course, that has changed. I mean, opera stars are much better actors now than they were before. But it's a very difficult process, singing very challenging material and maintaining the truth. Yes. One of the challenges I have as an actor is when I'm intimate, I get soft. And when I'm angry, I get loud. So a lot of the intimate moments that need to be heard in the balcony are harder for me because they need to be projected. Mm-hmm. And so you take them as far inside your body and protect them with caring as much as you can. But vocally, it's challenging to play those intimate moments. This is a challenge I've had all my life. I've been at it 50 years. To make those intimate moments as audible as they should be. They are physically palpable from my body, but they're not always as audible as I'd love them to be.
Before we get into acting full-time, I just want to, looking on your website, just wanted to comment on one thing. It says that you backed up the Ronettes and the Crystals they were the part of the Spectre Wall of Sound. Did you actually tour with them around the country, or did they just come?
No. I wasn't allowed to go on the train yet, so I just performed with them when they were in New Haven at Yale. Phil Spector was their manager, and he was trying to get the black girl groups to cross over. So he hired white girl go-go girls.
Ah, okay.
To give them more of an air of wholesomeness. But I learned most of the moves that I still do at parties from the Ronettes and the Crystals. I mean, they were hot stuff, and they had soul. And they weren't cutesy, like the kind of styles of dance I had been taught from being on American Bandstand. I was on Connecticut Bandstand, which is a small-down version of American Bandstand. Oh. So I learned how to do the mashed potatoes and the wah-wah-tusi from the Ronettes and the Crystals, and they really put their souls into it, shall we say.
Well, you had mentioned Carol Lombard. Let me just ask, were there any other female actors or actresses that really struck you that acting wise drew you in? I mean, some people will say they remember film noir and someone like Richard Widmark, or they'll remember Betty Davis or what. Was there one or two actors that were, you know, your people that you always said, "Mom, I got to go see that movie"?
Well, No, we mostly watch movies at home. I think the first movie I ever saw in a movie theater was Old Yeller. And I thought that dog was a terrific actor. I thought, wow, that dog made me cry. That was my first real visceral experience of a film. But we didn't go out much to the movies. Most of the experience I had was going to the theater with a field trip from my school. We'd go to the Schubert to see, what was it called? Do I Hear a Waltz, which was Sondheim and, Sondheim and Rogers music. I believe, forgive me if I made a mistake with that, or Anthony Newley toured in a show that wasn't a big success, but I got to see it. And then at Long Wharf Theater, seeing classic plays there, Sean O'Casey plays, Eugene O'Neill plays. I loved all of it. But in terms of female role models, I thought Katharine Hepburn in some of her films, I loved her verbal ability. She and Spencer Tracy had a great chemistry together in those Preston Sturges movies where everybody talked really fast and were really witty. I think those had a lot of influence on me. But I didn't really aspire to going to the movies much. And I guess we didn't have that much money, so it wasn't really possible to go to the movies that much. We were TV people.
Well, let me ask you about what was the first role that you ever did, like in school? Did you do the old Guys and Dolls thing? Was that the first thing you were in? Or what did you...
I think I was in Oklahoma in high school. Did I play? I think I played Nanette. She was trying to take Ado Annie's boyfriend away, and then I think I played the maid in Blythe Spirit, which was a coward play. Yeah. And then I was at Yale University. I played a prostitute in Threepenny Opera. And then I was hired to play that prostitute again, who had a special walk and a kind of a virgin style of being a prostitute with the New London Opera Company, which was my first equity-paying job. That's when I was 14 or 15. It was the first time I ever took a train. I remember how exciting that was. And that's when I think my parents realized I really meant it. I wasn't just kidding around. I was willing to risk my job at Sears to go to the Eugene O'Neill in New London, Connecticut, and be in the New London Opera Company.
Were you more drawn to drama, musicals, comedy, or did you like to dabble in all of them? Did you want to broaden your palate?
I loved all of it. I think that my father and mother so needed to laugh, because ours was such a black comic household, that I was attracted to performing and comedy first. Mm-hmm. And then later I learned to luxuriate in drama. I was attracted to all of it, anything that made me feel differently than in my life.
Uh-huh. Well, let me ask about comedy then. Did you grow up on television watching Three Stooges reruns or Abbott and Costello films or The Little Rascals? Or?
Sure, I saw those. Yeah. But the women that were funny were the ones that appealed to me. Uh-huh. And I think Phyllis Diller certainly had her influence. Uh-huh. She was a riot. But Carol Lombard's the one I remember because she seemed like a real woman, a real person.
Now, you said that you got your...
Judy Garland was a big favorite of mom and me. Yeah. Because she could see and really make you feel something.
Yeah, yeah. It's odd because there's a sub-channel now called, I think it's Get TV, and last year they were rerunning the Judy Garland show that ran in like 1962, all 30 episodes or something. It was really interesting to see how much television has changed, because there you could have Judy sing three or four songs, have her guest star sing two or three songs, and you'd have an hour full and she'd talk for 5 or 10 minutes with the guest. But you couldn't get away with that now because people are so bored by anything that has any depth. So you said you got your actor's equity card at 14. So you were a professional then by the early 60s.
I didn't really work very much until I was out of high school, though, of course. I went to Woodstock Playhouse, worked there as an apprentice. Diane Keaton was there as a journeyman that summer. And then I worked at Warwick Playhouse, upstate New York, and then I worked at some of the music tents, Falmouth, Cape Cod music tents in the summers. So that's when I really started getting money for what I loved so much. So I was in college at Adelphi, which was near New York City, getting my BA, and I would commute into New York on the Long Island Railroad and get little parts of things, which was great, soap operas, musicals and stuff.
So during this these early years, were you the typical struggling actor? Did you have to do waitressing jobs and little stuff on the side? Well, were you getting enough to sustain yourself in the business?
No, hardly, no. I was never a waitress. I think I would have been terrible at it. If people are hungry, like when I get hungry, they're not really very much fun to wait on. But I did work as a temp typist at a lot of the ad agencies on the east side of New York City, Benton and Balls, Wellsmith Green, J. Walter Thompson. The Mad Men era, I was working as a typist and a receptionist, and everybody there knew I wanted to be an actor, so they would let me use the staple, my pictures to my resumes. And so at lunch, I was auditioning for shows all the time, and I was working at EUE Screen Gems, which was a commercial house, and I had an expense account, and I was taking people out to lunch, and then I went to lunch one day and auditioned for a musical called Via Galactica, which was a space age rock opera that was opening on Broadway. It was Gal McDermott's third musical. Sir Peter Hall, without the sir, was directing it. Had a very luminary set of people above the line. And I auditioned for that, and I got it, and I went back to UE Screen Gems, and I said, I just got my first Broadway show. Oh, we're glad you finish up this document and do these things. I said, you don't understand, I'm leaving right now. So after that, my name was kind of mud in terms of working in production or assisting. That was a fork in the road. I definitely went toward the theater. But no, I didn't make a living at it for quite some time.
What do you think was the role, at least early on, that sort of gave you, made you feel, okay, this is what I'm going to do the rest of my life? In retrospect, was it a good job? Was it a good role? Or was it just a role that you said, I've got to do this, even though you had some reservations?
Well, I had no reservations about being in Via Galactica. It was my first Broadway show. I had a short love scene opposite Raul Julia. Huh. It had really incredible, talented people in it. Irene Cara was in, a lot of young stars that made later in television. But it nearly killed me. And I remember on its closing night, which was just a week or so after we had opened, I thought to myself, is this what it is, being in a Broadway show? It was very dehumanizing. It was a very technically difficult show, kind of like what Spider-Man became. There were a lot of risks in being in the show. We were supposed to be on another planet, and there were craters, which were actually trampolines inset into the stage. And we would leap from one crater to the next as though we were in slow motion, going across a planetary surface. And one or the other of us were forever snagging our ankles on the edge of the crag that surrounded the trampoline. And I got run over by a robot one night, but had to go on. It was just before we opened. And one day, this was the opening show for the Eurus Theater, which is now called the Hammerstein. I think it's at 50th and Broadway. The cement wasn't yet dry in the ceiling, and they had put these enormous winches into the cement in the ceiling to sustain this large kind of fire escape scaffolding on which the entire cast would climb to escape to another planet. And there was this rocket ship based at the bottom of the set, and it was supposed to take off with all this powerful sound and explosions coming out of it. And then the staircase would rise into the tail of the ship. Well, the first time we tried this, the winches pulled out of the ceiling, the entire cast on this staircase plunged through a trampoline and into the bowels of the theater. And some of the children at the bottom were screaming. Some of us had fractured hands and feet. So I thought, is this what Broadway is going to be? It wasn't at all warm and fuzzy and human feeling I was seeking. And after that, Peter Hall made me try the scaffolding every night to make sure it held. And then we closed down for a week. And the show opened, but it's such a disappointment. It was such a flop. And we all knew it was going to be, but we had to stay with it. And then I didn't work again for a while. You know, I had to go back to temp typing where I could get a job where my name wasn't mud. So it was disheartening and kind of a disillusioning experience.
Well, you mentioned, you used the word dehumanizing. I interviewed an actress named Carol Demas, who was the original Sandy on Broadway. And she had told a tale when I interviewed her about how she had to have an equity trial against a producer who had kicked her off a role that she had a contract on. And in your years in theater, have you found that, well, are things better now than they were when you started? Or do you still think that there's sort of a dehumanizing process, at least on the stage?
Most of the shows I've done since Via Galactica have not had that kind of technology involved. So most of them, you have been able to access your humanity in a safe space. But it is tough. I mean, it's tough. In New York, at least, you're doing 8 shows a week. You can't get tired. You can't go off and do other things in the daytime. Some actors do. Some actors do a television series and a play at night. I didn't have that sort of stamina that I could do that. But, no, I think that the other experiences I had beyond Via Galactica have been very human. The next show I did after that was Scapino with the young Vic. And that was an updating of the Molière comedy, The Adventures of Scapin. Jim Dale was in that, who was the voice of all the Harry Potter books, wonderful actor. And I did it with an all-British company, and that was very healing and reconstituting for me. We ran at the Circle in the Square on Broadway in the late 70s, and that kind of gave me my faith back, and it got me my breaks. A lot of people saw me. William Morris signed me. I began being sent to Los Angeles for pilot season. So I think that that gave me a credibility and a stature that I had lacked till then.
When we talk about stage acting, whether drama or comedy or musical as an art form itself, you know, when you're doing a stage play and you're doing the same lines and you're working with the same people night after night after night, how do you keep it fresh? You know, when you're doing the 75th or 85th or 112th rendition, and you have to walk around the couch to the right and the person says this and you have to suddenly, you know, is there a way that every day you sort of gear yourself up for it, or does it sort of just become rote and natural in a good sense?
Well, early on, I had studied with Stella Adler, and there was a certain craft that I developed. Whenever I found that I was in my, you know, 112th performance, and I was thinking about what I was going to eat after the show, I knew I needed to go back to class. And generally, it's a willful forgetting, kind of a forced stupidity that keeps you from knowing you've ever done this move before. It becomes kind of a meditative process where you completely liquidate the experience, do not know what's going to happen next. You're in a place of innocence and unknowingness and discovery. And that came with time. You know, in the beginning, you're so interested in being word perfect and move perfect. But now I tend to my work somewhat liquid, so that there is always an element of discovery and newness in it. And that came, I think, more from working with a teacher named Harry Master of Georgia out here in Los Angeles. The art of not ever recreating, but creating for the first time every time. So that you put yourself in a completely vulnerable, unknowing state every time you hit the boards. And it is a skill. It's the skill of willful stupidity.
I spoke with an actor who gave a little bit of an anecdote about Jason Robards, and he said that when he was a college student, he had gone to a play that Robards was doing, and he went backstage to meet Robards, and he told him that he was an actor, and Robards immediately said, "Did you see what I did wrong in such and such scene?" And the fellow said, you know, at first he didn't want to reproach Robards, but Robards insisted, whatever Robards had done wrong, Robards said, "Yes," and he said, "And that's the key to acting, is that you may know that you fuck up, but the audience may not know that because they're seeing you for the first time. You may know that you've done that 75 times in a row great, and this time you just were flat, but they don't." How important is it to tap into sort of the inertia, the energy of the moment, to keep going if you or one of your co-stars flubs a line or does something that, you know, could bring the play to a halt?
Mm-hmm. Well, you can never judge yourself or beat yourself up. I mean, that's the most important thing, is not to criticize yourself. You have to keep going. Your fellow actors are relying on you. And yeah, generally the audience does not know. I was just in a play, the first play I'd done in a number of years, and I came into the play 2 weeks after they'd been in rehearsal, so I had to play catch up really fast. So for a while, I was still running my lines in my head as we were working, thinking, fearing what's coming next. It hadn't become that autonomic in my body yet. And I loused up lines a number of times. And my film actors would repeat their cue or rephrase it in a way so that it sounded fresh. And I would, as we do in real life, I'd say, no, that's not what I meant. I meant this. And just covered over as in character. And I don't think the audience knew. They know when you drop something physically, but they don't always know when you miss a line. If nobody gets out of character, you're just fine.
You mentioned Stella Adler, and for people who know the name, they'll associate that with method acting. Do you consider yourself...
No, I'm sorry.
The opposite.
She's anti-the method.
Yeah. So could you describe what the approach of her approach is different from the method, rather, and have you learned to take just elements from that and move beyond it for what works for you?
Yeah, Stella had a falling out with Strasberg and some of the others who appropriated what they called Stanislavski's method. Stanislavski had a methodology for teaching craft, which involved sense memory, recalling your own traumatic events in your life, so you know the size of what was being required of you. Say I'm in a Chekhov play and I'm in mourning for my life. I couldn't use my own life because that would have limits. If I kept sourcing my own life, that would dry up in time. I would de-traumatize the element from my own life, or I would keep going into a wound so deeply that I would make myself crazy. Stella went to Stanislavski, studied with him in Paris, and learned that he had never said to prepare for a play by using your own wounds. He never said use your own sense memories. He said the experiences of your life, of suffering or of loss, will inform you as to the size, as to the intensity of what this experience might be like. But your imagination is unlimited. Your own wound is limited. Stella said, why would you want to play the death of your own dog when you want the death of your lover in this play? It was, who wants to see your small little life? We want the bounds of your imagination, unbounded. So Stella was very anti the method. She wanted us to get our imagining from the story given to us.
Well, you mentioned about getting your break on Broadway and then being sent out for pilot season. And I'll talk more specifically about roles that you've done later in the interview. But let me talk a little bit about differences between types of acting, because one of the first things listed, and you had mentioned soap operas, was that you had done a soap opera. Were you a regular, or was it just a 1 or 2 day gig that you did on a soap opera?
Oh, just a couple of things here and there. I was a waitress in the cafeteria on All My Children with Richard Hatch and Susan Lucci. And then I was on General Hospital, I think. Oh, not General Hospital, The Doctors. It's called The Doctors. I played a nurse on that. We had a flirtation going with one of the doctors. But it was just from time to time. Fortunately, unfortunately, I was not booked to be on a soap opera. It didn't seem like my world.
You did also some television. What's a guest stars? It looks like you did something like The Love Boat and a few other shows early on. Is there a difference when you're going in front of a camera for television? What basically is the difference between that and a stage actor? Because you're only going to have a small amount of lines in an hour show. Maybe if you're doing a guest role on something like The Love Boat, you might be on screen 5-6 minutes at the most. Is there a difference on set? How do you prepare differently internally, or does it depend on who the director is and what the set in general is like?
Well, I'm fortunate. I've had a very well-rounded training. I mean, I trained for classical theater, and I trained in improvisation, and I trained for contemporary theater. And the truth is the truth. And it feels the same, and it plays the same resonances in your body, no matter what size theater or television screen or film screen you're on. Certainly, actors love the luxury of doing a play. It's not financially advantageous or fame advantageous, but it gives you a complete immersion in a story and circumstances that are sustained, you know, for a long period of time. And it gives you tools, it gives you craft, it gives you so much back, so much more than television back. Get to repeat the experience night after night and hone it and finesse it and paint it. So being in the theater really reconstitutes me. Doing long scenes really reconstitutes me. Doing short scenes on television series, I've certainly done a lot of recurring roles. You have to have such a sizable backstory prepared for yourself and relationships with every face you'll interface with, so that when you come in, you believe you have a relationship with this cop or that you know this crook. You have to do a lot of homework, and you have to do it fast. Sometimes I've been hired to do a show 3 days before it goes. Then you have to go do homework 8 hours a day for days until you're called to the set, so that you can go into a love scene with a stranger and believe that you've had a marriage with them for many, many years. So you really have to have your craft in line. My teacher, Harry Master George, says, you know, anybody can be an actor, but it's the homework that makes you an artist. And I do a great deal of homework, no matter what role I'm preparing for or what audition I'm preparing for.
A number of actors have told me that when they've been in backgrounds of scenes, you know, if the two main characters of a movie or a film are having their tete-a-tete, you know, and you're in the background, that they will often work out an elaborate backstory for their characters who are sitting at a table, or a doctor and a nurse talking in the background. Do you do that? It seems like you did. And how important is that to add an element of realism, say, within a scene, if the camera isn't on you per se?
Well, first of all, it helps you hone your skills as an actor to have a life, even if you're playing a small part. And it definitely heightens the atmosphere for the scene itself. Not anybody can be an extra in a great film. There is a certain bedrock of skill that you need to believe the circumstances. It's not just putting on a costume and sitting somewhere. It's having a pre-life, I call it, and an actual life. So yes, I would say that probably prepares them for larger roles, working that way, having an imaginative life, even when they're extras or sitting in the background.
Have you encountered, when you've been doing a different forms of acting, whether it's stage, whether it's primetime guest roles, soap operas, bit parts here or there, doing voiceover and stuff, is there still a lot of the sort of stratified bias that some actors have? It used to be years ago, actors wouldn't do television. Television primetime actors didn't want to do soap operas. That seems to, at least in this century, have gone a little bit by the wayside. Have you noticed that change over the course of your career as well?
Yeah, you know, I aspire to be like the actors in England who would go from television to film to stage to small parts, large. Being a working actor has always been my aspiration, no matter what medium I'm in. Yes, that bias has gone away. I think that when I first started doing the cartoon series called Rugrats that I was lucky enough to start doing in 1989 and did intermittently over another 10 to 15 years, it's still on the air. Bought me this house, actually. At the beginning, there was a lot of bias on the part of celebrities about doing voiceover. And then they got wind of how easy it was and how remunerative it was and how much fun it was. Now you didn't have to wear makeup or high heels or a bra. And then suddenly, by the time we did our third movie, Rugrats did our third movie, Whoopi Goldberg was in my scene. Bruce Willis was in my scene. Everybody wanted to get on board. And now celebrities have crowded out the working actors a great deal in animation. Just about anybody that does a feature film animated project is the star. So I think that bias has gone away. There is still somewhat of a bias here in Los Angeles that if you're doing small theater, you're not interested in doing television or it's a fallback. Whereas most of the actors I know here who are doing 99 scene theater love it. It's an end in itself, and they're honing their skill set so they'll be ready for television. So they'll be ready for film, so they'll stay fresh for their auditions.
When you talk about acting that people rarely talk about, and one of the shows that we'll talk about later on a little more in detail was when you did the sketch comedy show, Late Night Show Fridays, and there in 70 or 90 minutes, you might have to play three or four different characters a night in different scenes. And, you know, I don't know, was that shot live as Saturday Night Live was, or was it taped? It was shot live.
It was.
So how do you go from, say, you know, I remember you were like the Jane Curtin anchor woman. You did those segments. And then if you're going to play some ditzy drunk in one scene, and then 10 minutes later, you're going to play some, you know, over the top Joan Crawford like character. Is that, how emotionally hard is that versus other types of acting? Or is it just so, you know, I'm going to just go out there and just balls to the wall, you know?
You know, I had been in a lot of improv shows in New York. In fact, Jane Curtin and I and Josh Mostel and Ray Baker were in an off-Broadway musical called The Proposition, where we would change periods, characters, scenarios every few minutes in order to support an audience suggestion. So I think that kind of improv background prepares people for late-night television. Almost everyone on these late-night shows has done a term at Second City or you know, Upright Citizens Brigade, and I had already done that in New York, so I was prepared to keep changing characters. One of my favorite things to do is repertory, where you're a different character in a different show every week. When I was in Sunset Stock, I would be Little Mary Sunshine in the daytime and rehearsing for Sally Bowles in Cabaret at night, and I just love that. You know, I love the ability to show all these different aspects of womanhood in a short space of time. So for me, it was just great. I love doing Fridays and shows like that. Although it's exhausting, the speed at which you have to change identities and the pressure on you to be funny and rehearse these things in 1 week, put them on air. It's strenuous. I noticed that the people on Saturday Night Live don't even learn their lines anymore. They're mostly reading the cards very deftly. And they may have their sense of who they are and the cliches that they're playing in mind, but most of them are reading. I think the guest stars are the only ones, the big guest stars, the only ones that actually learn their lines and work hard on it, because they're really on the chopping block. You know, they're really on peer scrutiny.
And so you've actually watched them, and you can see that. You've got a good enough eye to see that.
Yeah, oh, sure. I think you can tell they're reading. You can see them looking off stage rather than at one another. They're looking at the idiot sheets, we used to call them, or the cue cards, so that they didn't have to learn the lines.
Let me talk also about voiceover, because first let me ask you, you've done cartoons and you've done film. Have you done video games yet?
I have done a lot of video games, yes.
I know when I spoke to someone else, they said that video games, you are still under SAG, but they pay differently than films, in that you'll get money up front, but you don't get residuals. So do you prefer, let's say, doing animated films or video games, or does it depend on what the project is? And are there any, like, if you were to play Barbarella or some outrageous, you know, pornographic character in a video game, would you say, no, I can't do that? Or?
The Rugrats series fortunately had a lot of video games that came out of it, and that was very lucrative. I had a piece of that action, so that was a good deal. Yeah. And then I remember after that, I was hired to play a Russian soldier in a video game, and that was just 4 hours of work. I did not get a piece of it. It was a buyout, as they say, right up front, a certain amount of money, and it was SAG. And in that video game, I had to die about 20 different ways. I also had to kill people about 20 different ways. Dying required a lot of screaming, you know, knife to the back, knife to the front, or kill somebody, knife to the back, you know, or knife to the front, you know. So that kind of stress on my voice for 4 hours made me turn away from those sorts of vehicles. I needed to see the copy up front, make sure that it wouldn't damage my throat. But it was also so negative and nihilistic that I chose not to do so many video games anymore. The pay was not worth it for those 4 hours of ripping my throat apart and dying so many ways and killing people so many ways. But there are people that love it and are really wonderful at it.
Yeah, I did interview an actor who said that he's done it. He's one of the actors named Paul Parducci. He plays a lot of Goomba types, and he was, I believe it was him who said that he's done voiceover, and then voiceover where they did like Gollum from the Lord of the Rings, where they put the little things on your body. And so if not just the voice, but the body, you've done that as well?
Oh, yeah. They put electrodes all over you, and then they steal your musculature as well as your voice. And I know when I was doing Dee Dee Pickles, they didn't put electrodes on me, but they watched the musculature of my face while I was recording over and over. And as the years went by, I noticed that Dee Dee's mouth moves began to look more and more like mine, and her face began to look more and more like mine. It was like they really had stolen my soul, as is the fear in some Aboriginal countries. Yeah, I think it's a very easy way for them to take actors' work away. Why don't they just use the entire actor's body? Yeah. Instead, they choose your musculature to install in some bigger-than-life fabrication. It scares me, actually, about our profession.
Yeah.
And the fact that young people today kind of prefer those avatars to the real human beings.
Well, sure.
However, they still need our feelings, and they still need our talents to animate those creatures and those gargoyles and those avatars. So there's some work, but the salaries are smaller, and the renown, of course, is far less.
You've done, as I said, you did the Rugrats. Have you done more dramatic cartoons or animated stuff? And how easy or difficult is it as a voice actor to try to convey the emotion within the voice? Because I think most of the time, from what other people have told me, is you're recording the voice first, and then they more or less animate towards what your voice is. Or have you done more where they've already got, let's say, whether you're playing a mouse and you're trying to sync to the mouse's movements?
No, generally they animate around your face and your voice. I haven't done very much looping on shows, except shows that I was actually in where I had to come in later and make my mouth say different words or the same words. But generally they just animate it to my voice.
Yeah.
But I have done a lot of looping on other people's voices and other shows. And that's a great skill set to have in your pocket.
Yeah, well, the term looping, most people would associate with the European films, the Fellinis and the Bergmans of the 60s and 70s. Have you done, for example, voiceovers for foreign films or anything like that?
Oh, no. No, I never have.
No? No. Well, let me ask about a couple of other things, and then we'll end this first segment and then talk more directly about things. First, I wanted to ask, since we've mentioned a few times the actors' unions, SAG and AFTRA and Equity. So you said you had gotten your Equity card quite young. Was it difficult to get a SAG card? I know that some actors have told me that they had a lot of difficulty. Others said it was quite easy. Others even gave the advice that sometimes their advice to younger actors would be, you can get a lot of good training on independent films before you get your union card, and so that they would say that unless you get offered a big role right away, sometimes it's better to work sort of like in the independent film world. What is your take on SAG as a union and your career? Has it, you know, I mean, I would assume that you're a member in good standing and all.
Yes, I got into AFTRA first, actually, as a soap opera performer.
And now they're both together, both unions.
They are, yeah. And then I got into Actors Equity by doing Summer Stock. And I can't I know I've been in SAG for 40 years, but I can't remember how the hell I got into it. And I think I did do a couple SAG-eligible films before I went into SAG. I think I took my agent in New York's advice, didn't join right away. Got my feet wet, did a couple SAG-eligible things, and then joined SAG a little later. SAG was a more expensive union. The dues were very challenging for me back in those days because I wasn't making a big living. You know, nowadays, I worry about the young actors today. I don't know. They've made it so difficult to get into SAG, and the salaries are certainly not what they used to be. I think it's a producer's medium now. It's definitely not an actor-favorable circumstance. I feel like I lived in the golden age. The guys that are on The Simpsons, I think that show's been on 23 years now. Oh, we were in the golden age, you know, residuals and royalties. And I'm not sure about web series. I've only done one or two, but I don't think they give residuals or buyouts. I think they're all buyouts. But, you know, you'd have to speak to somebody who's more well-versed in that than I. I just work sort of on things I'm offered now and not auditioning all that much, so I'm not really quite sure.
I want to ask you about the female acting roles versus male. And I've heard this from, as I said, you're my 20th actor that I've interviewed, and I've done 10 male and 10 females. And down the line, the males, in fact, the last actor I interviewed said that he's just turning, or he's just 50 now, and he says that it's a lot gloomier for females because as a man ages, a man can, you know, be thought of to have wisdom or whatnot. Let me ask about the female acting experience as you age. You know, oftentimes you're the hot young thing when you start out, and then you start playing mothers and then grandmothers. But I've used this term often with some of the female actors, and most of them have agreed with me that Hollywood, unlike say European filmmakers or television shows, treats women in a very backward way. You can have a female character in a European series or film that is going to be thinking about things other than their femaleness, their need to reproduce. Whereas in America, actresses seem to be vaginas with accoutrements to most producers. And I don't mean that to be offensive if I offended you, but that seems to be the mindset. Whereas a European films and roles, they're fully flesh beings. Have you noticed that? Has it gotten better over the course of your career or not?
Definitely gotten better. I've had more action this last year than I have before. The roles have been interesting. For example, yesterday I was asked to read for a pro-life nun in a pro-choice movie. And I recently did a film with two very big young stars of Nickelodeon and YouTube fame. It just came out on YouTube Red, and I played an older mom, you know, of these two boys. They're app developers, and it was a kind of a typical sweet mom role. Like, your moms aren't quite so sweet as they used to be, like Dee Dee Pickles was, yeah, and Rugrats, but I played a sweet mom, and then last year I did a show called Switched at Birth, which is on ABC Family, or Freeform, I think it's called now. I was playing a New York producer looking at Leah Thompson's original music with her son. So I'm finding there is more of a diversity of roles now in the sweet mom and the sweet grandma, at least that I'm reading for. Much more than there ever has been before. I don't know what's changed. I don't know if Helen Mirren and Meryl Streep and Patricia Arquette's speeches to the public whenever they have the dais to speak about more employment opportunities for women and equal pay, but it's definitely a shift. I'm very happy about it. There were about 10 years where I was in this awkward in-between stage between femme fatale and grandma, where there wasn't much work. And when I did have auditions, I was up against Shirley MacLaine and a lot of older film stars. They were putting everybody between 50 and 80 in the same category. Yeah. So, yeah, as soon as we weren't fertile, we would fall into this kind of sardine can.
You mentioned going out for a pro-life character, and I would assume being living in L.A., that you're a typical liberal sort. Do you find that there are any
pro-choice? Definitely pro-choice.
Are there any roles that, let's say, you wouldn't do? You talked about some of the games that you didn't want to pay the money. I mean, if you were offered a role as, I don't know, some kind of repugnant character in some way or whatnot. Do you weigh, well, it pays well, but I don't want my name associated with that kind of thing? Are there some roles that you wouldn't do? Or let's say when you were younger, would you not do nudity just on principle? Or if, let's say, it was in an exploitative kind of slasher film?
Yes. I had a falling out with my manager just the other day. She wanted me to go on a show called Backstabbers to play one of the young leads' new stepmothers. And I read the role. I knew that I was going to be murdered in a future episode, and that kind of appealed to me. I'd never been murdered before, and I don't mind playing villains at all. But the language in which I spoke to my young stepdaughter was so appalling to me that I would talk to a young woman this way. made me turn down the audition. I mean, and also I wouldn't mind being murdered, but I was so roughed up, bound, gagged, thrown into a truck, stunt woman stuff. I tell my manager, you know, I don't want to align myself in this dark world, at this dark time, with this sort of woman. And I don't want to put my body in this sort of jeopardy on the set, because, you know, we all want to do a good job, and sometimes we take big physical risks with ourselves to make it come out right. So I did pass on that. Last year, she wanted me to read for a role. It was a typical cougar kind of role. There was nothing interesting about this woman. I seemed to be in this role completely duped by this young man's manipulations, and I didn't see that her credulity was at all possible. The fact that she would believe these things he was saying to her seemed, I said, can I play it as though I'm in on the joke and I'm playing it anyway to get the perks of being a cougar? No, it was just to be straightforward, so I kind of passed on that one. Then I was offered a role in an animated series to play an anti-Semitic character who was very anti-women's freedoms, and I passed on that. And that was an offer for an animated series. I just couldn't stomach it. So it's not made me popular with my management, I have to say. But I don't need the money, and I'm not that desperate right now that I want to sell out my values and my physical safety to do any old role. I know that hurts me. That's hurt me in the long run.
Yeah.
But I'm okay. I have my breakfast vegetables.
Yeah.
I have my house and I have my husband. So for the time being, I have the luxury of saying no to something that doesn't sit well with my values.
But you don't begrudge, say, an actor just coming up that needs the cash, if they need to do this role to pay their mortgage or something.
No, and, you know, taking that money, and they might even put it toward their favorite charity. I have a friend who's a vegetarian, ardent animal activist, who's done a lot of meat eater commercials, you know, McDonald's, and has made so much money that he's given it all to animal rights activist funds. So sometimes people will sell themselves out as actors to support their favorite charities to benefit their favorite people in need. So no, I have no judgment about it.
Yeah, I know. When I interviewed Stephanie Kramer, the actress, she said that when she was doing the show Hunter, one season they wanted to have her character raped. And she was okay with her character being raped because of that show. But then she said the next season they wanted to rape her again. And she was like, you know, what is rape, like potato chips? You just can't stop at one. And she said, no, I'm not. She said, the bad guy can beat me up, but she said no to rape. So they had to rewrite the episode. And I thought that was a good for her to do that, because, you know, the thing with me, it's always, as a viewer, it's, I don't mind nudity, I don't mind violence, I don't mind sex, but it has to be organic to the script. You know, I don't know if you recall a few years ago, there was the scene with Michael Fassbender where he did the role Shame, and he's walking around his apartment naked and he goes to take a piss. He's acting natural in his environment alone, and that's what people might do if they're walking around naked in their apartment. But all of the kind of scenes where you see someone just two hard bodies getting naked or something 2 seconds after they meet, what is the purpose of it? Are we supposed to believe that? So to me, it's always, does it organically go with the scene and the characters? Do you have a similar view?
Yeah, Showtime, example, is notorious for exposing women's breasts as often as possible. And I booked for the Emmys, and I've been sent a lot of shows to view, some of which are on Showtime. And I swear, I was watching this one scene between Don Cheadle on House of Lies and a young woman, and within 5 minutes, she was fully exposed. I mean, and gratuitously. They didn't show any of him at all. And I thought, ugh, I'm going to turn this off. I already vote no against this particular show because of that kind of titillation, you know, that kind of pointless, not related to the story kind of exposure. I have I'm very sensitive about violence, and it had better be germane and to make a point for me to sit through a show that puts my sensitivities in jeopardy. So I'm not hungry enough to do anything, and I don't begrudge other actors who are more open and are willing to do anything, but I have my certain dead ends and blocks beyond which I won't go. Not anymore, anyway.
Yeah. Let me just ask a couple of other questions before we end this segment. You mentioned Helen Mirren, and last year she had twitted or tweeted something to the effect where she said that she's often disappointed on sets when she works with younger actors, but because she's noticed that producers tend to cast the young actors not on ability, but by their Twitter or their Instagram fan bases. And so if an actor, it's not even just a matter of looks, but if an actor has, you know, 8 million followers rather than 200,000, that actor might get the role, even though they're not as good as the one with 200,000 followers. Have you ever encountered that kind of thing where you've been put in a situation with an actor or a co-star, whether it's by fan popularity or by looks, where they're clearly out of their element, and you don't have to name names, of course, but where they're clearly out of their element, and you're like, oh my God.
Yes, I just opened in a film called Alexander IRL, Alexander in Real Life is the real title, which premiered on YouTube Red, which is the new kind of streaming service like Netflix or Amazon. And I was asked to be in this film to play the mom. I had never met these actors or heard of them, but they had like 10 million followers each on Vine and on YouTube. Yeah. And this was the reason the film was being produced, because if only their fans, only their Vine or YouTube fans bought tickets, the film would be an instant hit. Happy to say, they were both very good actors, very natural. They had had training, and they were absolutely lovely. Two actors called Nathan Kress and Brent Rivera. They produced the film. They're all of 19 and 24 years old. And it's a whole new way of doing business. I was surprised and very happy to be part of it. The movie came out quite adorably, and it's being streamed like crazy right now, mostly because of their followers. It's a young people's film, but it is a whole other business model, which I had never participated in before. And my manager hooked me into their Vine and YouTube streams so that I would get some backwash from their fame and notoriety. So it's a whole new way of doing business.
The final question I want to ask has to do a little bit with what I asked earlier about women's roles. And last year as well, the actress Charlize Theron had tweeted something about not getting serious roles because she was too beautiful. And that the actress, whose name slipped my mind, who had started out as a child actress on Welcome to the Dollhouse, was like, oh, boo-hoo, Charlize, you know, try being a working actress. Obviously, an actor, it's a visual medium. So someone who's average looking, if you want a big, tough John Wayne type, someone who's big and good looking like John Wayne is going to get the role. If you want a Raquel Welch type, someone who's busty and sexy like Raquel Welch would get the role. Do you think that sometimes, though, the emphasis on physical appearance is too much, or what, when people are being cast in roles?
Well, certainly we all want to look at stars. I mean, men and women want to look at beautiful men and women. People whose faces are symmetrical and fascinating at any angle. Yes, it's definitely a visual medium. However, good actors, I mean, look at people like Danny DeVito, Linda Hunt. These people are no decorations, but their skills are such that they continuously work. They're continuously series regulars and producers because of their excellence as actors. Linda Hunt, I first saw playing a man, a Filipino man, in a film called The Year of Living Dangerously. Did you ever see that film?
Yeah, yeah. She won an Oscar, I believe.
It was Mel Gibson and Sigourney Weaver were in the film. They were quite beautiful. But the person that blew me away was Linda Hunt playing a man, a Filipino man. I never got over that. And of course, she's on a series now. The name escapes me, but it's been on for years. Playing a woman, a very strong woman in control of a whole lot of people, and she's one of the richest women in our business. And then, of course, Danny DeVito produces It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, a very scatological, silly show, which has been on for many, many years. So it's all about looks in this particular case. They're both adorable. Not to demean either of them, but it's definitely about their vision of themselves, their versatility, and their delight in work. Working.
Well, let's end this segment, and in our next segment, I want to talk about some of the things, some of the roles that Bailey touched on. Any anecdotes you have, and any other thoughts about the roles, and we'll do that in a moment. I'm speaking with Melanie Chardoff. We spent the first hour or so talking about acting, her life and career. And in this second segment, I want to talk a little bit about some of the more notable roles that she's played in film, television, and stage. Melanie, let me just ask you, since we talked about a few of the roles, can you tell me any roles on stage that stick with you, especially for one reason or another?
Well, I recently played Mary Pickford, the first president of United Artists Studios, in a play that imagined how the film The Great Dictator, which starred Charlie Chaplin as a parody of Adolf Hitler, how that she prevented that film from being completely shut down. So this was my secretary, as Mary Pickford's, imagining of what might have taken place, what might have happened when the German council came to tell Mary Pickford to shut the film down or all of her pictures would be banned from German and Austrian markets. And I had never studied Mary Pickford in depth before, but I watched a lot of her silent films and I watched a lot of documentaries in which she actually spoke. And I was able to incarnate her at an older age after she was a has-been, no longer a movie star, but a very powerful force in Hollywood. And it was fun to become a historical feminist figure. And this play ran at Theater 40, which is in Beverly Hills. It's one of the longest running 99-seat theaters in Los Angeles. And I was on stage the entire time, the entire 90 minutes. I had three terrific ensemble members to work with. One played Charlie Chaplin, one played the German propagandist, and another played my secretary. And we just had the best time. We had a wonderful time. I was playing an older character in a mature wig, trying to simulate how Mary Pickford looked in her 40s and 50s, and a costume from the period, and we had a beautiful set. They actually recreated Mary Pickford's office at United Artists Pictures. I was able to reenact the heartbreak that Mary Pickford suffered when Douglas Fairbanks became a terrible alcoholic, ran off with a younger woman and left her. I was able to reenact what it felt like to have been a major movie star and then had much less success when the talkies came in. And the delight in being a power monger at the same level as men in an era where women were not that often put in positions of power. So it was a really full-blown, four-dimensional, great theater experience. We got rave reviews. And up until the election night, the film was a bit of a comedy. Then, of course, after election night, it became all too real that some of the circumstances that occur in this play called The Consul, The Tramp, and America's Sweetheart could actually take place, that Nazism could come back, that politics could begin to control business and film content. It had a lot of foreboding for a lot of audience members, and it got a lot of media attention as a consequence.
Have you ever done, or would you want to ever do, a one-woman show? I recently did a show on the Marx Brothers, and one of my guests was a guy who travels around the country doing a role as Groucho every night.
Wow. I have done one-woman shows, various versions of them. Generally, I did them as benefits for various charities. In that way, the charity provided the venue, took care of the box office and the tickets and the money and all that, and I just brought my wares as a one-person performer on. I've done various versions. One evening, Lorraine Newman and I wanted to raise money for a breast cancer research project. We named our show Four Women, Women, and Julia Sweeney, Lorraine Newman, myself, and Ann Randolph did pieces of our one-woman show to benefit this woman's clinic. And then Lorraine Newman and I also performed a show called Half-Baked, in which she opened it in 1 hour of her one-woman show, and I did the second hour of my one-woman show. So I've done a lot of one-woman shows. It gets kind of lonesome up there, and you don't want to be up there much longer than an hour. I think audiences get tired of the one face, no matter how many roles it plays within its hour. And I think it's an amazing kind of new art form, the one-person show. It's very cheap to do. Usually they don't have any sets, many costumes, no props, and it benefits the theater directly. So I am thinking trotting out my one-woman show once again. This time my one-woman show has a terrific ending because I married for the first time 2 years ago. I'm a newlywed. Oh. I married as a senior citizen. So I have a book that I'm writing called Best for Last, which is about all the adventures I had as a single romantic feminist who finally met the man of my dreams in my 60s and tied the knot, now have kids. So it's kind of a very happy ending for a lengthy feminist searching kind of story.
Well, I didn't ask usually, but so you yourself don't have any biological children then?
No, I don't. I now have a stepdaughter who's extraordinary, and her husband as my stepson genius-in-law. He works for Apple, actually, as a developer of the new iPad. And then I have a son who's 25 named Sam. So I suddenly have, as they say in Jewish, the whole mishpucha. I have brothers-in-law and their wives and their kids, and I have family dinners. I have a very small family. I only have my mom and my little sister left on the earth, really, my direct lineage. So it's been a real boon. I have had a wonderful kind of new life just in the last few years with my husband as a psychologist.
I recently watched a documentary about the last few years of the life of Elaine Stritch, and she often did one-woman shows. What were the types of one-woman shows that you did? Were they just you doing monologuing as Melanie Chartoff, or were you playing a character?
All my shows have been about me, and the songs have been songs I've written about my own life. I have a song to feet, you know, to how odd feet are. They're kind of like pets that people put in your lap. And I just have very quirky, funny songs about what my first waltz was like. My first waltz was almost like a rape and a seduction. And I had no idea when I waltzed for the first time what I was getting into in terms of physical contact with a man. So I have a song about that. It's very hard to do these songs justice by just describing them, but they're all very quirky, odd, and a lot of them have dance in them. So, no, the story is very much about my own life, and the songs were very much written from my own imagination.
And have you written a lot of material for yourself as well, and is it mostly for the stage, or have you tried to, for example, do you have like a project that for years you've been trying to get produced as a film?
Yes, I have a project called Vivian's Voice, which is about a woman in her 60s finally escaping her husband and setting out on her own for the first time. It's been optioned by Lifetime. It did not get made. I had various wonderful actresses attached, like Shirley Knight, Marion Ross, but none of these actresses could get it produced because some years ago, it was very hard for a female older actress to get any money raised. If I could raise enough money, I'm old enough to play the part myself. I'm thinking of resurrecting it. It takes place in the 80s, so it's a period piece. And yes, Vivian's Voice is a film I'd really like to see produced. It's won all kinds of festival awards, competitions, script competitions. It's not been produced. And then I have a musical co-starring myself called Fine Lines, which is about a psychologist, it was played by John Savage in my last rendition. John Savage from The Deer Hunter.
Okay.
He plays a psychologist who has worked with a patient who's so disturbed that the only way she'd get her feelings out was by singing. And so he had, as a shrink, to go into duet with her and sing with her in order to heal her. So Fine Lines is this two-character show that I'm trying to get produced now. The theater that I just worked at, doing Mary Pickford, is looking at the musical in hopes of producing it next year. It's very inexpensive to do. It takes place on a bare stage with just a therapist office implied. Two characters, and they go from their 20s to their 50s. So it's a great challenge, and I've done the role again. Here's hoping that your show makes that possible.
Yeah. Well, let me go to IMDb. Since we've talked mainly about stage, you've done television and film work, and we've talked a little bit about the voiceover. We mentioned a little bit about some of the minor roles you did on soap operas early on, and I'm looking at IMDb, and I know that it's not always accurate. It looks like the two earliest shows you did on television were guest roles on Wonder Woman and the Tony Randall Show. Which one of them did you do first?
Oh, I did Wonder Woman first. That was so much fun.
And it says your character was Nadia, so I'm assuming she was a Russian spy or something?
No, I was a Russian gymnast, like Nadia Comaneci. Oh, and they made me look so much like an athlete. They had a stunt double for me, of course.
Yeah.
And she would spin, and she would jump, and she would do all these moves on this horse.
Yeah.
And then I would leap off and land off the bars. I was indeed, Nadia Comaneci. And my boyfriend was Rick Springfield, who became a big rock star soon after that.
Yeah.
Lovely actor. So that was my big, and I was playing, Henry Gibson was the villain who I had enjoyed so much on Laugh-In.
Yeah, yeah.
So I just had a blast. And here I was, a young girl in peril, but most of the time I was laughing my way through that entire guest shoot. It was just so much fun. And then Michael Keaton and I played students of Tony Randall on his show, in which he played a law professor.
Yeah.
And
He was a judge.
13. Yeah. Oh, he played a judge who was teaching law. Yeah. That's right, at a college. I played one of his students. That was a complete gas. Yeah, so some of the first things I did in Los Angeles that made me decide to stay.
Yeah. And then it looks like your first film, American Hot Wax, that was about the DJ Alan Freed?
That's right. He was accused of taking payola. I played either Patience or Prudence, one of those two young girls. Do you remember the song they sang? It's like, I know you belong to somebody. So I got to sing in the movie and cry, and that was a great deal of fun, too. I think Lorraine Newman was also in that film. There were a number of us, Fran Drescher, Jay Leno, who all had parts in that movie. And Jay and Fran and I were all doing stand-up at Bud Friedman's Improv Club during those days, so we kind of knew one another already. And that was just a gas. Everybody was in it. Everybody I knew was practically in it.
I've talked with a lot of actors who mentioned that some of them have friends that they make on set, especially when they were younger in their careers. Have you kept up with a lot of these people from early in your careers? I mean, do you socialize, or are they, your Facebook friends, or are they just, mostly co-workers that, you might have worked with two or three times over a 30-year period?
Well, I knew Larry David and Bruce Mahler from New York Improv Club.
Yeah.
And then when we ended up on Fridays, we just fell into this easy collaboration, familiarity, because they felt like cousins to me. I mean, we had spent so many hours in the trenches together at the Improv in Hell's Kitchen in New York. And then we stayed in touch for a while, but then our careers dispersed us. They took us in such different directions. Larry did me on Seinfeld a few times, which has been very remunerative. I just, keep getting checks for my Seinfeld reruns. It's just such an amazing gift he gave a lot of his friends. And then we did a Friday's reunion DVD.
Oh.
So we got to work together, again and meet up again some years later. So we've gone in and out of each other's lives. I went to see him in his Broadway show last year, which was called Fish in the Dark. It wasn't a critical success, but it sold out every night, and he was the biggest toast at Broadway for the 6 months it ran, so I was very happy for him, and we hung out afterward for a little bit. I know them, I love them, but I don't see them much. I did see Mary Edith Burrell. I went to visit her in North Carolina, where she teaches screenwriting at a university in Asheville, North Carolina. So we love each other, we're like related cousins, but we don't get to spend much time together. We're all in different parts of the world.
Yeah. Well, before I get into Fridays a little more in depth, I guess there's one other thing. It looks like you did voices for the old 1970s Saturday morning cartoon show, Super Friends. Were you doing multiple voices, or were you just Wonder Woman?
I think you're telling it to me is more than I know about it. I think, yes, I just played Wonder Woman. I hardly remember it. At all. I'm so sorry. I've done so many things in my life that have new nieces and nephews now. They'll be watching Rugrats. And they'll say, do you remember when you did this? And I'll have to say, golly, I'm so sorry. I don't remember. I did about 300 episodes of that show. And I don't remember that moment I did that. Sorry. Because I didn't physically do it in real life. I just did the voice, the words associated with it. So I've done so many things. I've been so fortunate that I don't remember them all. Maybe certain moments here and there.
Well, we've mentioned Fridays before when I talked about sketch shows, and it seemed that like around 1980, the late 70s, early 80s, a lot of sketch shows came on in the wake of the success of Saturday Night Live. I think Howard Cosell had a sketch show one season.
Did he?
Yeah, it was horrible. And then And then there were a couple of other late night ones. Some were locally produced. I mean, Second City Television came out of Canada, and Fridays was I think the best of them. And by the time you came on, I think the first wave of the Saturday Night Live people sort of had gone. And I always liked Fridays a bit more because I at that time Saturday Night Live I think just had Eddie Murphy and Joe Piscopo. They were sort of in a downtime, and yours seemed to be that seemed to be the coolest show. How did that come about? Did you have to audition for it, or is it a group of people like Larry David that you knew that said, "Hey, Melanie, you know, I'd like you to do this, sketch show with me"?
No, Larry was a hireling just like me. We auditioned, we screen tested, we improvised with other people who were auditioning and got hired from just a cold audition. I didn't know Larry was going to be on the show. He didn't know I was. I didn't know Bruce Mahler was going to be on the show. But I think we had been seen and scouted as stand-up comics in New York and in Los Angeles, which gave us a certain heat when we came in the door. So, just a happy happenstance. And then when we were on the show, they had us present all our material so that the new writers, there were a lot of new young writers like Larry Charles, who was an 18-year-old boy from Boston who showed a very unique, dark voice. Now he's one of the biggest directors in television. Larry Charles has directed all of Bill Maher's shows. He's directed a lot of the Curb Your Enthusiasms. He wrote and directed a lot of the Seinfelds. But in those days, he was an 18-year-old that came up with the weirdest goth kinds of sketches, like Diner of the Living Dead. I don't know if you ever saw that, but a zombie restaurant where people could get a side of a hand sandwich with a side of spleen. He had just bizarre ideas. So it was just an audition, and it was a day.
Did you contribute to the writing of sketches as well?
I did. You know, it wasn't a show that was very friendly to the female point of view, unlike Saturday Night Live, where Lorne Michaels, I think, has always been a big supporter of the female vision and the female voice. Look at Gilda Radner, look at Tina Fey. I mean, he's a big, stalwart supporter of women. Kristen Wiig, he's been a producer of some of her films. It was not a female-friendly atmosphere, and I don't think it's because they were trying to squelch us. I just don't think they understood our humor. I'll give you an example. It's a bit risque, so tune out if you want to. But I wanted to do an ad for Stay-Free mini pads, which were pads that you could stick on your hand. They had an adhesive. I think they still exist. And so I showed how you could clean your counters or clean your child by sticking one of these Stay-Free mini pads on it. And the men were so grossed out by this. They just could not tolerate my humor. And the women thought it was hilarious. So they outnumbered us. And hence, as we only had one female writer on the staff, and she was like one of the guys, we couldn't get those sorts of pieces on. So most of the show, the men had the leads. They had their characters written for. If there were musicals, the men had the leads in the musicals rather than the women. We were trained singers, all of us. So there definitely was a locker room mentality on that show, sorry to say.
It only ran for two seasons. Was that the network just didn't have faith in it, or do you think that had the? I mean, because I don't think it was did that poorly in the ratings as I can remember. I'm not an expert on those things. Why was it shut down, and why wasn't it given, say, a longer run? And do you think if the network had maybe been behind it more, it might still be around the way Saturday Night Live is, or do you think it just was a passing fancy?
Oddly, ABC produced the show itself, hired a production company to run it. The production people they hired were not comedy writers. They weren't writers of any sort. They are people who had worked for ABC before. I don't think it generated enough material once Reagan got into office that could keep us topical and interesting. Once Reagan got into office, who we had spent 2 years trying to keep out of office, we felt spent. Yeah. I mean, it was no longer funny. Kind of like, I'm not sure how much longer Alec Baldwin, the Trump character on Saturday Night Live, it's not that funny anymore. So I think that was part of the difficulty. We also had a lot of lawsuits against us, if I recall. Whenever we parodied or poked fun at some of the Republican characters, they didn't seem to have the sense of humor as we had hoped.
Yeah.
So there were like a lot of lawsuits on the table. There was a lot of censorship of some of our more radical ideas. So we began to feel kind of doomed and staggered along. I think we did 71 shows.
Yeah.
So it's a little more than two seasons. They kept picking us up in increments of six shows, but we were never a confident hit. We were spotty. Our ratings would go up and down. Yeah. And I think that some of the things we like to do with, for example, with Andy Kaufman, began to stray into reality TV. We were trying to create real trauma on the show that was highly compelling to watch, like any auto accident. For example, we had Andy Kaufman on as a guest. And in one of our more illustrious sketches, a sketch that we were handed at the beginning of the week, we didn't have an ending on it. So we were all very suspicious, and then just before we went to shoot the final show, the live show, our producer, Jack Burns, told us that Andy was going to blow out of that sketch, and we should all improvise with him. And so we did. It was a sketch about two couples going to a high-class restaurant getting stoned. And one by one, each just go to the restroom and come back altered, so stoned. And Andy came back and just blew out of it. He said, I don't want to play stoned. This is stupid. And then he and Michael got into a pseudo fist fight. Then the crew, not knowing...
When you say Michael, you mean Michael Richards?
Michael Richards, yeah. Got into sort of a semi-fist fight with Andy. And then the crew, not knowing that this was an improvisation, leaped into the fray, grabbed Andy, and started to rough him up. And then they went to a screen, you know, a signal screen. And, of course, when this hit the press the next day, we were quite the toast of the town. It got higher ratings than almost any other show, and our show thereafter for quite a while was quite notable. We were definitely watched more closely. And then we tried to beat our own game, create more and more shocking incidents. So it was sort of the first incidents of sensationalism getting ratings.
Yeah.
I didn't care for it. You know, I thought we should get ratings legitimately with our talents, but that was not the way the network wanted to go. They were really hot for big ratings, no matter how they were gained.
I mentioned earlier that you had the sort of Jane Curtin role as the newsreader there. Was that your favorite segment or character, or what was the favorite character that you had, and what was it a role that you created that came from your mind?
Michael and I created a situation called The Battle Boy, where he was a violent little child, and I was his sister, and we would go out in our fantasies of what our yard was. We would improvise those. For example, he would see the backyard as a battlefield for his soldier dolls.
Yeah.
And I would see it as a picnic, kind of romantic picnic ground for my Barbie and Ken dolls. And then I would bring them out and he would bite my doll's head off, or he would set fire to my Ken doll. And we did a series of those, and they were so much fun. First of all, I loved playing this little girl. She was so demented and perverse. And he was so demented and perverse. So I think that was my favorite of the shows. I have to say, being the newscaster was not my favorite position, because those jokes were written last minute. I would be handed these jokes and I'd get a chance to read them down once before I went online. I was always fighting for what next piece was or what my next words were. And because I had that position as newscaster on the show, I wasn't written for some of my characters as much as I would have liked.
Yeah.
So that was disappointing. I did like playing the demented little girl, and I was written for that character a lot.
Well, I'm going to use Wikipedia as the source of this next thing, and it's probably wrong knowing Wikipedia, but you can tell me if it's so or not. You had mentioned that you had have done work in the years since Fridays with people like Curtin and Lorraine Newman, and you mentioned a few other Saturday Night alumna.
Julia Sweeney.
From what Wikipedia says, it says that after Fridays was given the axe, that Dick Ebersol had approached all the Fridays cast members if they wanted to come and join, but they turned him down. And since you had said earlier that it was a more female-friendly environment, were you just sick of sketch comedy at the time? Or what did you say, well, did you think Saturday Night Live was going to tank too? Because they weren't doing that well in that era, I think, either. Or what was the reason?
I think we were all burned out. Yeah. It was an exhausting schedule. We worked 6 days a week, writing it, rehearsing it, watching it hit or miss.
Yeah.
And I think we all wanted to go to something else. I definitely wanted to be an actor, and I was reading for sitcoms and more dramatic shows in which I actually get to be more vulnerable and more weird, not be in my head all the time, in which the scripts were written well in advance and there was a Bible to show that we could count on. So that was my reason. Dick Ebersol was very lovely, but I didn't feel like it was something I wanted to do at that point. They did talk about making Fridays a primetime show, and they did talk to me about doing that. I think you did a couple sample episodes at the 8 o'clock time slot, but that was such a handcuff to our writers, having to be so straightforward. You know, the amount of risque stuff you could get away with at 8 o'clock was far different from what you could get away with at 11 o'clock at night. So it felt too tame for all of us. I'm an actress first, but I'm a very edgy personality, and I don't always like to do things that are really square and mainstream. They don't feel right to me. Rugrats had an edge to it. It was kind of broad and dark. So,
well, after Fridays, it looks like you did a number of guest roles on some shows like The Love Boat, St. Elsewhere, and then what catches my eyes is it looks like you did a film called Stooge Mania. Was this one of those like tribute films? Was it a documentary that you were doing the voiceover about their career, or what was that?
It was actually starred Josh Mostel and myself. He's obsessed with the Three Stooges, and every scene that we were in, he would be imagining they were in the scene too. And it was a very clever merging of their footage, their antique footage, with our contemporary footage. It's still on Netflix or something, somewhere. You can still see it. But it was all to set up these mixed scenes. Like when Josh and I got married, for example, in one scene, there's a pie fight, and the Stooges are in it. They have actually cut their footage into our footage.
Yeah.
It's kind of like when Gene Wilder danced with that mouse.
Yeah.
In Singing in the Rain.
They were Gene Kelly, like, not Gene Wilder.
I'm so sorry, Gene Kelly. Yes, and it wasn't very successful, shall we say.
Yeah.
But I had a good time doing it.
Well, I see that you also did the typical 1980s miniseries, something called Fresno. I have no idea what that was about. Was that like some Larry McMurtry kind of Western or something?
That was one of my favorite things I've ever done, and I'm sorry it wasn't a huge success. It was a takeoff on Dallas.
Ah.
It was a pseudo miniseries starring Carol Burnett.
Oh.
This is Dowager, wealthy Dowager. Terry Garr is her daughter, and her son Billy Paxton. It was about the raisin industry in Fresno, in which one of the characters is thrown into the assembly line, dehydrated, and then boxed in little boxes of raisins. And I played the attorney to Billy Paxton, trying to get him off for this apparent murder that has been pinned on him. And we had the greatest cast. We had Chuck Grodin, we had Dabney Coleman, Gregory Harrison, Carol Burnett, Terry Garr. It was one of the most fun experiences I've ever had. And my character, her name was Desiree Du Mornay, was a lawyer who cared more about what she wore to court, getting her dry cleaning, than getting to court on time. It's a great role, very broad. It's produced by Barry Kemp, who later produced Coach. He's a very successful producer in television. I think he owns a hockey team now and has gotten out of the business. But it was so wonderful. And it was a big hit in London, not as big a hit in America. They didn't get it, I don't think. They didn't get the parody element.
At least on television and film, you're more noted for comedy. But I see that you did a few episodes of the old 80s show Wise Guy, so I'm assuming that was dramatic. Has there always been a desire for you to sink your teeth into, you know, a dramatic role? You know, would you want to be the mother of, you know, in A Long Day's Journey into Night or something, you know?
No, I wouldn't want to be the mother in Long Day's Journey tonight, thank you. But yeah, the role on Wise Guy played opposite an actor named Jonathan Banks, who has more recently been known as the character Mike on Better Call Saul, and prior to that on Breaking Bad. He played Ken Wall, played Ken Wall's undercover assistant in this undercover cover-up thing. And I played the girlfriend of Jonathan Banks. So I only did about 5 or 6 episodes, but yeah, it was a very rich role and a very wonderful series. I don't know if you remember it, but it was about obsessive men, and I have to say all the men on the set were very obsessive. and dark, and it was really a thrilling ride. I got to play opposite Jonathan Banks, who's just a terrific actor, and I think he was delighted to be playing a romantic character for a change. I don't think he's gotten to play romantic characters that often in his career, so it was really fun, and we went deep.
You mentioned working with Carol Burnett, and I see you did also a recurring role on the New Hot Show of the 80s, where he was the innkeeper. Did you play his shrink or something?
Yes, I played his shrink. I played Peter Scolari's shrink. I played Julia Duffy's shrink, and I played Tom Poston's shrink. They somehow kept using me over and over again to be the psychologist for all of them. And actually, my role seems gave a message as to how the show would end. At one point, they brought in Jack Riley, who had been on Newhart's
right.
last show,
yeah.
where he played a crazy patient. Jack Riley, incidentally, had been my husband, Stu, on Rugrats, so we had a long familiarity. And as I was letting Jack out of my office and welcoming Bob Newhart and his wife, Mary Fran, into my office, Bob Newhart and the Jack Riley character, I forgot his name, stared one another down, and Jack Riley said, "What are you looking at?" And so as we came into my office, Bob Newhart said, "I don't know why, but that character strikes me as so familiar." And I say, "Oh, well, I'm trying to repair the damage done to him by that terrible shrink in Chicago." So when the that Newhart series ended up as being a dream, a leftover dream, and he was still married to Suzanne Plachet in the last series, my scene was instrumental in signaling that that was about to occur. Foreshadowing.
Yeah. I interviewed another actor who was actually had done a few roles on the first Bob Newhart show in the 70s. And I want to ask about sets, because I talked with some actors who've talked about a number of sets where it's a long-running television series where guests would come on, and sometimes they were treated as second-class citizens. Bob Newhart, on the other hand, the fellow I'd interviewed who'd done a few Bob Newharts in the 70s show, said that the Newhart set that he was on was always professional, and Newhart himself was always gracious. Did you find that as well with Newhart particularly? And have you done some sets where you're like, I'm not going to do another episode of that show ever again?
I felt very welcomed at Newhart, you know, invited to lunch, made part of it very quickly. They wanted me to be a regular on the show. It didn't work out, but I had a really good time the days I was there. Julia Duffy and I got along great. She was wishing they would spin us off into a new series. I think she was pulling for that. We had such great chemistry together. I love them all. I had a great time on that series. There's certain shows that you're on that you want to go on and on. I was one of the leads on a show called Parker Lewis Can't Lose.
Yeah.
With a bunch of young actors like Corin Nemec.
Yeah.
And we had such a great time doing that show. I was thinking, compared to Via Galactica, which was my first Broadway show, which was so dehumanizing, because of Clive Phillips' humanity, that show was the most functional family I've ever been part of, the Parker Lewis show.
Yeah.
And they wrote for me very well. They dressed me quite beautifully. I was running a high school like I was Eva Perón running a small South American country. I was a narcissist. I was man-hungry. I had a sadistic streak. It was the most fun villain I've ever played. And I'm so sorry that show only ran 3 years. As opposed to Fridays, where we're all burned out and we wanted it to be over because we were so tired of being criticized, the bad boys in the media. Being on Parker Lewis, I could have gone on with that show quite a while. And with the Newhart show, I just had a great, great time.
Is the Parker Lewis show the show that you're still recognized by the most amount of people, because those fans would have been young and now they're adults?
You know, it's different. I mean, the other day I was visiting my mom, who's turning 93, in her assisted living facility in Camden, Connecticut, and a young woman waiting on our table in the senior cafe said, "I know your voice. I know your voice." She recognized my voice from Rugrats, I think, which was really odd because I hadn't been using my own voice on that show anyway. But people will look at me and know that I look familiar, and they'll start feeling that they know me from their cousin, or I'm related in some way to someone in their neighborhood. But they don't always know that I'm a television personality. So no, at this point, I'm sort of remembered for reruns, and they can be many of my different roles that I'd rather than one role. Although Parker Lewis is on reruns somewhere because I'm getting money. I don't know where, but it's running somewhere.
Well, the Parker Lewis show had a different sensibility than Newhart, and also it looks like you did an episode, at least one, of Married with Children, and that had its own sort of vibe. Are there certain comedy shows that you're more comfortable with, in or certain types of comedy? You know, Newhart had have that sort of, I mean, he had that classic pause, and, you know, he was a reactive comic. Married with Children was the over top with the overt sexuality. What Parker Lewis at that era was more sort of, I guess you would call it, young, hip, MTV kind of editing. Are you more comfortable doing certain types of comedy or not, or do you just roll with the punches?
Well, I'm comfortable doing comedies in which I'm pivotal in the comedy. I am not as happy being a straight woman to a bunch of funny guys, which was my position on the Friday show a great deal.
Yeah.
Being the ingenue, being the straight woman, being the one who is the butt of the joke rather than the reason for the joke. On Parker Lewis and on Newhart, I was often not just reacting to a funny guy, but the reason for the laughter.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my favorite kind of comedy role to do, in which I'm allowed to be funny, which I am. Not right now, but I am. Trust me, I am. And as a stand-up, I was very funny. So I like when those roles come along where I don't have to make faces or do distortions or be really broad, but the writing is so good that all I have to do is say the lines truthfully to get laughs. That's my favorite kind of role to do.
Speaking of comedy that has its own sort of zen quality, you did a few episodes of Seinfeld, which reunited you with Larry David and Michael Richards. Was that sort of like, did you work with either of them closely? Were you like Kramer's girlfriend, or what role did you play there?
I was George's girlfriend, one of his many girlfriends, and I was not one of the funny girlfriends. I was one of the reactive girlfriends. I played a woman who George is dating, and I have a young child, so I invite him to come over for my child's birthday party, which is attended by my mother on a walker and a lot of older friends. And I'm so excited to have him for the birthday party, but at a certain point, a hamburger catches fire in the kitchen, and smoke begins to billow out of the kitchen, at which point George, in his efforts to get out first, knocks over my mother on the walker and all the children, including my own child, in order to get himself out of the building first. So the next scene is the fire department rescued everybody, and I'm asking him why he didn't rescue the children or myself or my mother, and he got himself out first. He said, well, someone had to lead the way. I'm sure a lot of people have seen the episode. And then in the final cycle, I was on again, and I testified against him for being such a selfish, inhumane person. So was the extent of my role, but I enjoyed doing it, and I think that Larry and those was kind of like Robin Hood, wanted to give all his friends a break, and he knew by putting us on the final Seinfeld, which I think was an hour and a half long, a real expansion of a very thin storyline, he hired 50 of us to do the show. We were all paid handsomely, and we all had trailers, we all had great food, and we've all gotten tons of residuals from our appearance on the final Seinfeld, which was an anticlimactic ending to the show, because it was not par with the earlier Seinfeld episodes. It was a very long, drawn-out, flimsy little plot in which they're all in prison.
Yeah.
And all testifying.
There's a show, it looks like, I don't know if you were a regular, called Weird Science. Was that a show where you were a regular on?
I was a recurring mom on that show. I think I replaced another mom. And I think I did about 7 or 8 episodes playing the two boys' mother. That was a show in which I had to put my foot down about a lot of things. There were certain words I would not say. It was a very sexist, titillating kind of show, and mm-hmm. I wouldn't play into that. So that was a show where I held the line. I actually turned down coming back, and they paid me double, and my agent talked me into coming back.
Uh-huh.
So that was a difficult show for me.
And then it looks like in the late 90s you did, again, a lot of the Rugrat movies and video games and whatnot. I'm interested here, though, you did an Ally McBeal. That's what kind of a set was that? I know David Kelly is considered one of the best writers of the last 25 or so years. What was your character on that show?
On Ally McBeal, I played a woman who has begun to turn orange. And I've hired 2 of Ally McBeal's associates to protest a wrongful dismissal lawsuit against my employer, who's, I say, is dismissing me because of my color. Mm. And I'm trying to play into landmark decisions about race and such, and they're, you know, they're trying to sue him, and he's trying to get off. And it was a terrific episode. I was in the scenes with a lot of the principals. However, the judge on the show had a stroke and passed away during my scenes with him. He was a wonderful actor, been on their show for several years. And I forgot his name, but he was a funny little wizened old guy. He would ask people to see their teeth when they were
was that on the stand. Was that the guy from My Favorite Martian? No.
No. He was another character actor.
Yeah, he was on Picket Fences, the earlier Kelly show, I think.
Maybe another David Kelly show.
Yeah.
And sadly, he passed away during the episode while I was shooting with him. So they had to abandon finishing the episode, and then they rewrote the whole episode and brought us all back. And so the episode was no longer about my dismissal and my lawsuit against my boss, but it now became about the loss of this job. And there was a lot of gospel singing. We were all singing and dancing. So I think they didn't want to waste his demise on my particular episode. But I had a good time there, and I met Peter McNichol.
Yeah.
And I told Peter McNichol he was looking for a house, and I said, you know, the house next door to me is up for sale. Came over and he bought the house, and he's been my neighbor ever since.
Oh.
So 12 years now, so that's how I got my new neighbor.
Well, if you enjoy the show, tell him I'd love to interview him, too. Send him the link. So it looks like with the turn of the century, it looks like you did a lot of videos, Dr. Dolittle 3, another Rugrats. It looks like you did. Did you do a short film here, End Out Into the Bright Blue Sky? Was that like a college a student film?
I don't remember. I'm sorry.
Oh. Okay, well, let me see what.
Sorry, I don't remember. Oh, God, that's how long a career I've had.
Let's see. It says 2012. Voiced by Academy Award-winning actress Louise Fletcher, and Out Into the Bright Blue Sky meditates on the quiet lost memory and the abiding alchemy of joy. The film Braids 3, let's see it. Braids, portrait of a young woman shot in Super 8, a tracking shot. Okay. Well, it doesn't have a
smile. How was I? I have no idea.
Well, it could be that you're not. I interviewed another actress, I forget who, when I quoted, I think she said, oh, no, that's a Canadian woman with my same name. So maybe it's a Canadian Melanie Chartoff.
No, I don't think there's any other actress who would adore the name Melanie Chartoff, in all honesty. But yeah. I'm not sure if that I came out in that or if it ever came out or what it was.
Well, the other recurring role it looks like you had was in a show called All Grown Up. I don't have any idea what that was. That a cable show?
It was a spin-off of Rugrats, where we're all 10 years older. Oh, Dee Dee is menopausal and has a bit of a belly, and her red, perky hair is now gray, and we all spoke in lower voices. So whereas my Dee Dee Pickles character spoke like this and had a very happy voice, the Dee Dee menopausal voice was more like this and more a little more depressed and a little more tired.
Yeah.
So that was the all-grown-up character that I played. And that ran for a couple seasons, but it was certainly not the success that Rugrats was.
Well, you said that, you know, you're in a good place now, at least with your residuals and from Rugrats and a lot of the other things. And that gives you, I guess, a freedom that a lot of actors, some that I've interviewed, don't have in terms of taking roles. You mentioned Alexander IRL, and I'm just looking it up. It looks like it's coming out this year, if it hasn't come out already.
It just came out last weekend.
Oh, okay. Do you now want to get back into doing more in front of the screen work rather than voice work? Or if, let's say, you spent the next 10, 15 years just doing voice work, would that satisfy you? You mentioned, you know, you have your own project you may return to. So what in the future are you looking for your career to go in what direction?
I would really like to be on camera more. I would really like to be fully dimensionally in things, especially now that they're allowing more older women on the screen. I would hope there's more opportunities for me to be funny and pivotal, to play loving characters, to play villains. I'd love to do more of that. I've sort of gotten over my self-consciousness about appearance that is so foisted on younger women, femme fatales in this business. You've become so self-aware, constantly self-conscious about how you look when you're on camera. But I think I've passed the age where I have to worry about that. And it takes a lot of pressure off. It's an enormous relief for us older women in being accepted as old women and still part of the mainstream of life.
Did that affect you in terms of like eating disorders or in terms of psychology? Did you have to see a shrink or something that, you know, oh, Melanie, you need to wear a push-up bra or you need to lose a little on the hips or whatever?
No, I've never had a weight issue, from overeating or anything like that. I eat a lot, mind you, but no, I think because I was a character actress, even as an ingenue, I thought of myself as a character actress, that the pressure to be perfect wasn't on me. But you still, you know, when I was on Fridays, I was the ingenue on that show. There was a certain pressure to look good, but the pressure was on the makeup artist and hairstylist less than on me. Mm-hmm. But you still, when you're putting bikinis on a show or you're in tight-fitting outfits like it was on Port Louis Can't Lose, you do become aware of how you look. And it's kind of fun to look good. But I don't have to worry so much about that anymore. Those are not the kinds of roles I'm going out for. I'm not the romantic heroine anymore.
You use the term character actress. I know some actors that I've interviewed have no problem with a term like character actor or actress. Others sometimes feel it's limiting. Did you ever, was that your goal that you were going to just do whatever roles appeal to you? Or did you at one point, you know, want to be, Olivia Newton-John in Grease or something?
I've just been kind of a working actor, and I would audition for whatever they sent me on. I never really said, I only want to do this, I only want to do that. I've just been fortunate to occasionally fall into the register section of my skills and the written role, which made me famous. I hadn't set out to be famous or to become a celebrity, but those were sort of byproducts of the roles I happily got cast in. And now, even at this Asian age, I still have energy. I still have a mouth on me. So I would like to play outspoken feminist women. I played Elizabeth Cady Stanton, one of the first big American suffragettes who tried to get women the vote last year in a play. And I'd love to do more feminist characters, role models. People really need them now in this anti-woman era that seems to be upon us again. So I'm hoping for those kinds of full-blooded roles in which I can have some positive influence for younger women in how they carry themselves in the world.
You mentioned that you only recently got married. Was your career and or celebrity a reason that you put that off and didn't, you know, have children or anything? To what degree did your career influence good or bad your personal life?
I was pretty busy and career was definitely a priority in my 30s when I should have been thinking about those things. I was so goal-oriented on career, and the man that I was living with also was so career-oriented. He was a producer. I think we sort of forgot about having children until it was nearly too late. I was in my late 30s when it suddenly occurred to me we didn't have much time left. And I remember speaking to him about it, and we both had to put pedal to the metal and do some thinking about it. And I think we both decided that it was too late and we didn't have enough financial or career security to do it at that point. And so that moment passed us by. And I didn't have big regrets about it until I was in my 40s and I was playing with other people's babies that I really had some sorrow about it. But as life turned out, it's probably best that I'm nurturing in other ways and not as a direct hands-on mom.
Well, let me just ask a few more questions and then we'll wrap up in the final segment, talking about your plans for the future. just looking on your website, you have now, you're starting to do seminars called Charismatizing, Improvising. Is this like Tony Robbins kind of thing or Marianne Williamson? What is the purpose of that? Are you trying to get people personally or in business? What is your role there?
For the last 10 years, I've been doing these workshops called School for the Shy or Charismatizing Improvising. And I use Viola Spolin's improv games to help people hone stronger personae in the world. So, no, I'm not a spiritual teacher or a political maven in any way. I'm just helping people who have introverted or introspective demeanors to come out of themselves more so that they can do TED Talks. So that they can do seminars from a place of strong stage presence. I work with nerds, geeks, brainiacs. I've taught up in Silicon Valley. People who have been very introspective in order to do their creations and their work suddenly have to come out of the closet and speak on their own behalves and present and do videos like you're doing now in order to sell their product. So what we work on is improvisational theater games from a place of presence. It's less about being cute and clever and more about being a powerful stage presence so that people pay attention when you speak. You want to be the best possible spokesperson for your product, and that's what my classes help people become. They get to be less physically inhibited. They hone their body language and their way of speaking so that people really want to listen rather than tuning them out. So that's what charismatizing improvising is about. And I also coach people on Skype who have to make a public presentation and are very scared. I work with authors who've never had to be in media before, who suddenly want to sell their books and do book talks. Help give them a voice, a way of dressing, and a personality for that.
We've talked about women in the business, but I also see that you write for a number of Jewish magazines and publications. Has that been in any way an influence on your life? I'm assuming then that you're Jewish. And if so, has it gotten better over the years as well?
Only as a child did I feel about for being Jewish, oddly. There was a lot of prejudice in the very conformist neighborhood I lived in. It was mostly Protestants and Catholics. There was some separating and dividing me out for my Jewish background, although my parents did not practice Judaism. They were atheists and agnostics. It was still recognized that I was not one of the usual religions where I lived. In later years, I have never felt any kind of singling out because I was Jewish. I support Catholic causes as much as I do Jewish. I directed a Catholic television show for a couple of years with one of my shy, introverted clients. I met him on Skype. He wanted coaching because he wanted to host his own television show. He didn't know how to go about this, but I helped him become less of an introverted Catholic journalist and more of an on-show host kind of personality. And he told me the idea for the show that he had, and I thought it was a spot-on idea. It would be sort of the Yule Hauser of churches all over the world. His idea was to celebrate the traditional Latin Mass, the traditional art and architecture of the Catholic Church, the Gregorian chants, the art, architecture, and the liturgy. And I said, I think it's a great idea. I helped him create a pilot. He and a partner of his from Dublin, an Irish girl, who I also coached, came down to San Juan Capistrano, and we shot a pilot there, commissioned San Juan Capistrano, which is one of the oldest churches in America. And then we shot a second episode in Boston at Charles Church right after the massacre, right after the Boston bombings, right after that marathon. A lot of people came to church for the Latin Mass that particular week, so our show got a lot of notoriety. And Alex, my client Alex Bacon, took those two pilots that we shot to a network called EWTN. And the show has been on ever since. It's been about 2 years now. It's a big hit. I stay on as a consultant. And the show takes on his journey from church to church, old Gothic churches still in existence in different parts of the world, in different parts of America. So I have from Catholic to Jewish to Buddhist, celebrating all these religions and their accoutrement.
I also see that you're involved in a number of charities. It looks like breast cancer, children's charities, and whatnot. Is that mostly you doing performance benefit performances for them, or are you also involved in decisions on boards of any of these kinds of charities?
In addition to performing and doing benefits in various places like Santa Monica Playhouse, the Women's Clinic of Beverly Hills, I also work with young girls at inner city girls with an organization called MOST, which is known for putting single older women together with at-risk inner-city girls. And this has been a wonderful collaboration. I've worked with two girls, sisters, Isabel and Angelica de Los Angeles, who are from Oaxaca, and their parents are non-English speaking. And I started palling around with them about 12, 13 years ago. And now Angelica has graduated college with honors and is starting her career as a social worker. And Isabel has graduated high school. They're doing very, very well and finding their way in this world. So that was my favorite experience as a non-performer getting involved with a charity, because I actually, rather than donating money, which we all do as much as we can, certainly, I got to hands-on being and be involved with these two girls as they grew into their lives. I went to Angelica's quinceañera. I bought graduations, and I've been part of her family. So it's been a very rich experience. It's given me so much back in those years where I realized I would not be a mom, but I could still nurture in other ways. It's been of great benefit to me.
You mentioned earlier in the interview that you're a member of the Television Academy, and just looking on your website, do you also vote? So you vote for the Emmys, and do you also vote for the Oscars as well?
No, I'm not a member of the Film Academy, just the Television Academy. And as a series regular, you're inducted into the Television Academy, and fortunately they send me copies of nominated films, so I get to watch them in the sanctuary of my own home with my own sound system and my own big screen TV, rather than going out to theaters. So that's a boon. And I get to have some small say-so in what I think is excellent television and what is excellent acting. And there is better and better television and better television acting now on the tube than ever before. It's just remarkable, some of the incredible shows. There's too much of high quality to watch. I think that's one of the problems for all of us viewers.
Is there a lot of politicking that goes on? I mean, when you get sent a DVD screener for this show or that actor or whatnot, do you also get like a lot of mail from their PR people or whatnot?
I get these enormous packages of PR material for these television shows. Not just a DVD, but sometimes it's in a birdcage, or it will come with a loaf of bread and a wheel of cheese. And it's oftentimes a deterrent for me voting for them, because it feels like an overcompensation. The shows that don't need that kind of hype are generally the shows that I vote for. Certainly Breaking Bad didn't need any wheel of cheese to get my vote, nor did Bryan Cranston or Aaron Paul send me champagne to get my vote. So I have noticed that that's sort of fallen by the wayside. There is not quite so much packaging involved with trying to get my vote.
Okay. Well, let's end this segment. In the final segment, I just want to have you talk a little bit about what the future holds for you, and we'll wrap things up in a moment. I spent the last couple of hours talking with Melanie Chartoff, an American actress, about her career in film, stage, and on television. Melanie, now as you're looking at your bio, as you're heading now towards 70, I know a lot of older actors have told me, and I've interviewed people into their 80s now, that aging is not as bad, is not as big a death sentence as it once was. So do you look forward to, say, your next decade or so as being as busy as some of your earlier work? I mean, do you see, you mentioned YouTube Red and the Alexander IRL show. Do you think that there are more opportunities to work now than ever before, and quality-wise?
It depends on my representation. My manager, sad to say, recently passed away. So I'm seeking representation now. It's the middle of pilot season, so it's a little hard to get people's attention. Uh-huh. But the fact that I do have recent film, I think, will help me. Uh-huh. I'm also performing at Comedy Central's Sit and Spin, uh-huh. Which is a spoken word show, a piece of material that I've written on February 16th here in Hollywood. So those tend to get a great deal of attention. So I'm sort of putting it out in the universe that whatever you want to take me for, universe, I'm ready to go. Eager to finish the book I'm writing, which is called Best for Last, Reflections of a Late Blooming Baby Boomer Bride, which is about getting married the very last minute in one's life, in an era where there's some disposable income and there's more spare time and children are all grown. I'm having a wonderful time with my husband. It's like a big, long date. We're having a great time. So I'm writing this book for all the women who I've told that I married for the first time at age 65 who say to me, you give me hope. So I'm hoping to become a spokesperson for that group, and I'm going to be taking my book out to publishers and agents all over the place now. So I'm looking for representation as an actor, as a writer. I'm at one of those crossroads, and it'll be exciting to see what happens next.
What would you consider, say, now, as you look back on your career, is there one if you had to pick one role that, say, someone would have to watch you in, and you mentioned earlier when I asked you that you didn't want to, say, play the mother in Long Day's Journey and Tonight. If the best role of yours is in the future, what do you think, you know, what kind of role would you want to play then?
I'd like to play somebody who's accidentally funny, who doesn't know that her thinking is distorted, who doesn't realize that she's reached a lot of absurd conclusions about life. I kind of like playing off-center, edgy characters. I'd like to play someone surprising and unpredictable, and generally characters that I've gotten to play have been somewhat twisted. So I look forward to my next twisted character, a little bit over the top, a little offbeat.
And finally, since I hope that at some point younger actors now or in the future will look back at this, do you have any advice for younger actors in terms of both as a creative artist? Because one of the reasons I'm doing this is I think a lot of people don't realize that acting is an art. You know, it's sort of like pop music. A lot of people just think it's in the background and don't realize that it takes an art to do that. And if not advice as far as the craft, is there any advice in terms of being business savvy that you would give?
Well, my focus is always on craft. Go to an acting class with someone of high reputation. Read all the books you can, written by some of our elders, like Uta Hagen, wrote Acting is Believing. Read Stella Adler's books. I think it'll give you a context for a profession that you hopefully want to have lifelong. Take a class in improvisation if there's a good one near you, one that makes you feel comfortable, not like you have to be funny or make funny faces or funny note voices. Do yourself a film. Do a YouTube of high caliber. Get someone you trust to direct it. Light it well. That one film might be your calling card to getting taken seriously as an actor. In the old days, we would do a play off Broadway. There were all kinds of places to perform as a stand-up, but I'd say now people don't go out of their houses as much as casting directors anymore. Got to get yourself a one-minute killer performance of what playing a character that you do best, fully realized, get good feedback on it. But I say study, study, study. First of all, it's exciting and fun, and you want your skill set to be above the norm. You want to be an exceptional artist, not just a competent actor. That's my suggestion.
Well, MelanieChardoff.com is Melanie's website. Anyone can find her there. I'll link to that as well as her IMDb page below this video. So I want to thank you for spending a couple of hours talking about your career.
Thank you for being interested.